So far, you've made Ah Kew The Digger, and then the following film about the Raja Laut, and then also another one about the Wayang Kulit Dalangs. And this is over a period of 2004 to 2012. That's three films over a 8-year period. And of course, we all know that documentary filmmaking is extremely painful and painstaking and I would say taxing exercise. Why then did you choose this subject as a film, you know, to make here?
Documentary is quite fun to shoot, because you get to see different people and you get to know things that you don't know. Until you shoot it, then you know. It's actually quite interesting. So it's like, you go in and you see different people and they tell different stories. So shooting it, I think, is actually quite fun. So I think the taxing part is when you come to an editing room, when you're not shooting anything, you have to make the story squeeze into, like this one is 72 minutes, so you have to squeeze everything into 72 minutes and to tell the thing. I think that part is require a lot of patience and a lot of thinking. That part is not so fun anymore, and come to editing is not so fun. And how to make the footage work together, and yeah. Even though shooting takes a few trips, it's still quite fun, because for me it's fun because you get to see different people and listen to different stories. Quite fun.
But yeah, but it's quite obvious that you've been very selective with what you make. I mean, like most documentary filmmakers or most filmmakers in general tend to churn out a lot of films over their career. And I understand yourself now, you're still involved in the film business, in the film industry. Why do you select this as a subject to make the film about? Because, you know, clearly it must mean something to you, because three films and two of three is about the same thing.
I think the topics I normally choose to shoot is normally very local, and sometimes with a history background and some maybe some cultural aspect as well, it will make me interested to cover. But most of it, when I shoot, even though it's history, we have history background, and even with the elements of cultural, I will still choose to shoot something based on contemporary person. Back in that time, it's contemporary person, because it should, like, this documentary was made like 16 years ago. So back then, the situation, I think from that time when I shoot him, I think, because back then he's not as famous as now. Now he's more famous. So back then he's not really, he's nobody yet. So I feel that this character should be shot and it should be shown to Malaysian. So that's why I think back then, I think he's somebody who should be, I should do something about him, I should shoot about him. And of course, it's when I shoot him, naturally he will bring up all the history he know, he will tell me the history, then I just cover naturally. So, but the focus is still on him. Still on him. This is, I want to shoot him. So he will tell me another story. So following, I shoot another two documentaries, the same thing. The latest one I shot, which is, I never haven't publicized yet, is about Dalang in Kelantan, which is also about the Dalang. But the Dalang themselves carry a lot of cultural values, so it will come out naturally as well.
I just want to ask you one more question before I open up the floor. What I noticed in this film is, I mean, as much as Ah Kew has amazing camera presence and his his chemistry with the camera is really amazing. But what I noticed also was that he seems to have very good chemistry with you as a filmmaker. And that really comes from the film. Because, you know, it's almost like I'm looking at the camera work, I'm looking at the way he talks, it's almost like you guys have a dance going on together. Like he's on cue to sort of like just talk to you. It feels like, you know, like the two of you have amazing chemistry. Like, have you known him for a long time prior to that? I mean, are you guys friends? Like, what's this relationship that you have with Ah Kew, actually?
Actually, I met him with in a gathering. So, at that time, I find in a gathering, I realize he has the amazing character that I should put him into a documentary, and then I showed it. After 1 year later, after I know him, so within the 1 year, actually, I was thinking how to do this thing. So I know him not very long, then I start to shoot him. But I guess the language and the, we are from the same place. So when we talk, it's very easy. We go into the topics and we have a very good chemistry, because I think the way we think also quite similar. Our frequency is very near to each other. So I can know what he wants and he will know what I want as well. So it's quite easy to work with this person. I think it's very easy to work with. The frequency is something come with language, and also I think the lifestyle can share some similarity back then. When I do the later one, which like the Dalang and those, I start to realize the chemistry is not there anymore, and the frequency also is not really clicking anymore. So it's very specific, and it's not every time you get it. So this film, when I shoot with him, he had a very good documentation process. But after that, when I come to editing, then I realize I didn't really shoot him on what his experience of trying to publicize the book. Even though I know that, because when I cover the documentary, I already know the book is actually already out when I shoot the documentary. But I want to cover about him in a reenactment way. So actually, I didn't shoot him telling his own story, but I only get some actors to do the part he experienced when he tried to approach the publisher, and the publisher is actually there today. Mickey Mouse shirt here. So, and two more friends actually helping me to complete the story with what he experienced during he tried to publish the first book back then. So the first book he actually used his own money to publicize. Now of course he has a few more books. Now I think he come up with 5 books until now.
Right now I'd like to open up the floor if anyone has any questions. Yeah.
Yeah, my name is Iswan. So ultimately, what was Ah Kew's breakthrough? How did he get? So he used his own money, and after that, since you say he published, so who ultimately sponsored him or things like that?
The first book he come up with was his own money, and he publicized the book. And by reading the book, I actually picked some characters from the books, and I actually shoot more than the characters you see here, but I only select a few to go in. So the second book, he get more attention, but I think back that time it's not that hard anymore compared to the first book. I think people start to have more trust on him, so some will help him. I think the second book, he got somebody to design and lay out for him for free. I think the third book, I think he got even more people helping him out. Now I think the last, the the really recent book, he can actually just fund it by himself with everything. So in a better financial stage to publish book. Now, yeah. He even like write for newspaper column on Chinese newspaper. So some TV interview him as well.
Fascinating subject. My question is, I have lots of questions, but I'll keep it short. I'd like to find out what the impact of your film has, your documentary, what impact it's had on Ah Kew, and if it's helped to further publicize his work.
I think the film did manage to get more people to know him, and some of them is actually help him out on the book, the following book. In the way it's helping him to come up with a story, I mean the book. So that I think is very obvious to me. I help him to not really help him in the way that film actually helped to publicize him as a writer that can do history writing. And then for him.
Yeah, I've noticed that his a lot of it has been about his books actually, and he's big on writing the history down. Does he ever have plans to? I mean, this one sounds a bit meta. Does he have plans to make a film with his findings? I'm just wondering. Because I've throughout the entire film, I don't see him, you know, taking any pictures or shooting any video, which is a pretty common practice by most film historians and anthropologists. Yeah.
I think when this was shot like 15 years ago or more than that, that time the camera and handphone is not that common yet, so he still rely on pencil and paper to write something. I think nowadays I saw him using a camera and even the phone to shoot photo, which is helping him to document things. He's starting to do that. I mean, he didn't refrain himself just to writing. So video, I don't think he shoot anything with video yet, because I think video is a bit tough for him. Sometimes he can struggle with even some simple computer stuff, so I think video is a bit too complicated for him.
Has he come back to you to,
yeah,
to, you know, to maybe like, hey, let's work on collaboration or making a film or?
We did another one for the Raja Lal, and it's a one story by himself, the Raja Lal, but it's the Raja Lal is actually from Perak, then. Yeah, he exiled in Indonesia, Sumatra, then become another pirates there, died there as well. So we went to Sumatra to shoot this story. So that was done after a few years later after Ah Kew The Digger. So we went there and shoot. Also, quite a fun experience, a few days shoot. Because we shoot it when he's original plan is just to go there to observe. There's a ritual there to burn the tongkang. The tongkang is a bunch. So every year they will do that in Sumatra, which is a common practice for the Hokkien clan in Southeast Asia. So we went there during the procession and we shoot that procession and we shoot the story beat of this history bit of this Rajala at the same time. So, yeah.
Hi, my name is Yvei. Firstly, thanks for the great film. We really enjoyed it. I'd just like to ask, I think you might have noticed during the showing of the film, there were lots of laughs from the audience. How much of the decision to have humor in your film, how much of that was deliberate, you know, in terms of what you told the actors and characters? Did you tell them to, you know, be quite funny?
Yeah. Because Akim is a funny person, so the essence of is easy to me, it's actually quite a fun person as well. So all this I try to maintain. Sometimes it's not from him, but sometimes when you see the character is quite, it's quite because when we do history stuff, the you will always think that it's boring, it's not funny, it's just boring, it's just facts, numbers, years and all this. But it can be presented in another way, which is quite interesting. So is when you even if you go to shoot, you notice a lot of things is actually it's interesting and at the same time it's it has so much fun to do it. So try to maintain those in the documentary. Normally in my documentary I will incorporate all these elements inside my documentary, which is you can just want to see because things that interest me is actually the subject itself is interesting. So just try to bring it to the documentary. So just to maintain as much as I can from the people, from the conversation, from the way they react and all this, you will see it's actually more interesting. It's different from when I do a feature film, it's different. So I won't purposely put so much of these elements inside. Because dramas, a feature film or story based on supposed to be, they have certain level of drama inside. So you don't have to be,
Please pass the
mic to him after that. How did he find any money to support his film?
He's a simple person. He's a simple person.
Okay, I'm Jagong from Utah. And actually this one for my class asked one. Did you encounter any political conflict when shooting this film? Like any people try to don't want you to meet this story and try to like threaten something? Threaten you doing this good thing?
Okay, maybe we can answer the first question first and then
yeah.
We can move on
to
the second.
I think two questions also about Ah Kew, so I can talk a little bit about Ah Kew. So Ah Kew is a very simple person, he don't need too much thing. So he is very simple and he just when he want to do the book, he just want to do the book. It's as simple as that. When you write the book and he will try his way, and if his way doesn't really work, then he will put it aside, and then he will wait, and then he will try again much later, and then he don't have specific strategy or anything to make it happen sooner or anything. So, but somehow the first book still come out eventually with his money. I think the first book actually he got some money from his own family member, from the brother, who actually eventually think he should contribute to the book, so that's the first book who come out. So the first book is actually pretty much from his own money, and second and the following book he has much better support from the friend and from the community as well. So the following book is can see is not much stronger on coming out with the book. And then I think when we shoot the film, it's not so much of anything stopping us or anything, because the film ultimately is about Ah Kew, so he don't have much enemy in Taipei, so he has a lot of friends, so even when we shoot something, he can suddenly walk to the kaki liver and then he can talk to the beggar, and the beggar will actually he can talk to the beggar and they both know each other, and hawkers will, especially hawkers, he know most of the hawkers because his father is making the kuih and all these things. So they are sort of like know each other and can talk to each other. So there's a lot of person, if you take the camera and follow him and walk in the town, you will see that there's a lot of people he know and they can just tell him. They will just tell him the thing, today the thing is like this, today my food doesn't sell well and all these things, you're telling the story. So it's quite an interesting guy. But we shoot the film, we have not much problem. Nobody is stopping us or giving us problem. But when he write the book, then he has to judge, because somebody will want him to write something and somebody will try not to tell him something. So he will have to judge which are the right approach and who is the person you probably get rejected to be interviewed, or people you could probably have a lot of people will encourage you to write his story, especially person who want to get covered or get famous.
Thank you for the film, very interesting. The fact that you've gone on to make other films of a historical nature, and the fact that the subject of this film has managed to put some books out, that suggests that the appetite for history is growing. Is that true?
It seems that you actually make a lot of film about
Are people becoming more interested in history?
I interested because of him. So actually, I have some interest on all these things. But it doesn't go very far when I link to the right person. In this case, it's Ah Kew. So he make me want to know more, especially in Taiping. Even the Dalang one as well, I think it's the same thing. I know only a little bit about Wayang Kulit, but when I see them, when I do the documentary, it makes me want to know more. But when I, let's say if I leave them and come back to KL to work, then it will stay there, it won't grow so much. This is my situation. So it won't bring me too far when I didn't stay together with them. So you get back to my work and all these things, then it doesn't grow continuously, or rather you will stay there.
I guess you can say becoming a bit of an argue yourself in that sense. Because I see this parallel between you and argue actually, because he seems like a lone ranger to me in his work as a historian, and you as a filmmaker, you know, you seem to me as a lone ranger yourself, you know, because you wrote, direct, produce, shot, I suppose, most of the film by yourself. And I think that's what makes this film kind of interesting for me, because it is two very sort of similar people working together, on different levels in that sense. That's a comment I want to make. Is anyone else, any questions? Yeah.
Okay, hi, my name is Carmen. I just want to ask you a question, because I noticed there was an interesting moment in the film when you were telling the story about the man who was put underwater, and then he had a metal chain, and I noticed you had one person tell the story that he was underwater for 7 days and another person was underwater for 3 days. And I'm just curious, when you were interviewing Ah Kew and he was talking, how can you be sure what he's saying, did you care about truth or what is really accurate? Because obviously people are telling all sorts of stories, and did you as a filmmaker care too much about that? And also, did you think Ah Kew cared about that? Because when you write a book, I guess people expect certain things to be more or less accurate. So just curious what you think about that.
I'm Andrew.
my question is sort of like following up Linda's questions. She was asking whether there are more people interested in history. I want to ask, you know, the film was made in 2004, so the technology of making film then was very different from now, right? Because we can shoot it with our phones and stuff. But do you see more interest in documentary films in Malaysia? Obviously, we have seen a lot more documentary film about Malaysia, but do you see, you know, more interest among filmmakers, among audiences?
Can we answer these two questions first? The first question about what is the truth, what is the real truth? I think this is a very, I think every filmmaker, documentary maker, or even historian, they ultimately they want to find out the real truth, what is the real story, where's the real version, because there's so many versions when you do field interview and all this. So same goes to me when I go and follow him and tell the stories, then many versions will come out. Especially when you have when you do the second version, the second documentary we do about the Raja Lao. When you interview the family of the pirate, they will tell you one story. When you interview the story of the victims, then they will tell a different story. So who is the real story? And sometimes Ah Kew, when I ask him, he cannot be 100% sure. He will say something is something in between, or both is not reliable, both are biased. So of course when I shoot, I will have to believe certain version. I have my own beliefs. I think this one is more likely to be real, more likely to be the truth. But in some cases, I put different story, put different versions in it. Sometimes I just purposely put a little bit, sometimes I put a lot. Things that I'm not really sure on, I will purposely put a lot. Things that I'm quite sure that I think this is the right version, I'll put probably just one version. But none of the documentary I made with is only have one version. I think normally I'll have a few versions because I think it's only it's only fair that to remind the audience that there is another version out there, and sometimes I'll just show a little bit, then at least I'll remind you that this can be seen from another side of the story. And sometimes a different version will make it more interesting as well. So you have to think differently. With the different version you have to think differently. Of course, everybody wants to know the truth, but back then nobody documented, so it's a bit hard to find out what's the real truth.
I guess one second question, do you think this film has generated interest in other filmmakers to pursue documentary as a medium?
I hope so. I hope so. Well, I can only say that I see more documentaries being made up. So even though I think easier we made to be phoned or straight away upload to YouTube, I think it's fine, I think it's good. With more coverage, I think even small things can be documented. So yeah, I think it's a good sign, and with the media is going to the more people can actually use it to shoot, and I think it's fine, it's good. To put together a good story is another challenge, it's another level, but I think overall, like nowadays when I watch something, I just watch it on YouTube. I just follow certain small story, certain interview. I just see it just like that. So I don't really need to see a long form. Even like this one, 72 minutes, I think nowadays not many people can survive. So if you put it in a short one, maybe people will finish it. Because the short one will probably have the gist of the story in a nutshell, which I think it will work for people nowadays, including me, myself.
But I guess that's a shame, isn't it? Like I've watched this film for the first time in 2004, and now 13 years later I watch it again, and I realized what I really miss in filmmaking in Malaysia is that that sort of a, I wouldn't say that brani is that thing where filmmakers were not afraid to take their time to tell a story. You know, like a 30-second long shot was not a problem back then. And I have to say, I really miss that in films nowadays. And actually, to answer your question, whether Eng Yow and I have encouraged more filmmakers to make documentaries, I actually watched this film in 2004, and it was one that I think there were very little independent documentaries made in Malaysia at that time. I remember there was Eng Yow, there was Amir Mohammed, and maybe two other people who made. And I myself, I thought, hey, let's make a documentary. So at least it has sort of, it was one of the few films that I watched that made me want to make a documentary. Yeah, so, yeah.
Hello, my name's Lawrence. For friends who weren't able to get here today, we're thinking of lots of people who would love to see it. How can they see it?
Actually, I uploaded on YouTube, so can just search Ah Kew The Digger and can find it. Yeah.
Great. So you have a DVD as well, or
we have VCD back then.
VCD.
We have VCD. I have some VCD nowadays. Yeah, but I think it's easier. You just click on YouTube.
It will be easier, but we need to keep you going as well.
Yeah.
How about your other films? Are they available?
They are on some of it YouTube, some of it DVD. Mostly in DVD, because YouTube back then is not so popular yet.
I think
so,
you want to know, do you still have the film, I think?
Yeah.
Can we buy it
from you? Yeah, I have. Maybe I just get your contact later.
Thank you.
Hi, I'm Angeline. I would like to know if, like, you don't know the interviewer, is there any tips on interviewing the person? Do you guide him on saying what, like, guide him in the direction that you want, or like you just let him talk whatever he wants?
I think it's best don't talk to him first. Don't interview him straight away. Just talk first. Everybody is comfortable, then we start. It's better if we can wait, then we better wait. So also is for me, it's easier for me to do it if I can interview him doing certain things that he normally do. Let's say if I want to interview the fisherman, I probably will sort of like go to his place, and then at least his place is familiar, then I do the interview there. And if I can use his language, I will use his language. And just adapt as much as you can to his normal daily life. Then he will, some of them, he will prefer not to look at you or look at the camera. He will do his own thing, especially if the person is from village like that. He try not to look at you. So it's okay, I mean, just carry on, just get him, because he probably want to tell you, but he don't want to tell you in your camera way. So if you have somebody who can talk to the camera and still feel very comfortable, like you, is your luck. But if you don't, because documentary, you don't know who are you interviewing, and you have little control over them. So yeah. That's only just try to adapt to their way, their preferred way, but they won't tell you their preferred way. So you have to see what is the thing work best. If you have some time and you spend with them first, then only you start. Then you have a better interview. If you can wait, I think better this way for a while.
That you had collected a lot of information on other personalities that have been highlighted.
now this in the documentary, I think I just show in the book he written is really about 100 people about Taiping. All of them is already passed away. So I just picked seven or eight I put in the documentary. When I should actually shoot more than that, like 10 over 10 person, but I didn't shoot a lot as well, because 100 is too much. So this 100 I picked a few and then I shot them, and when I edit I only put certain person in that works for the story and that works to tell who Ah Kew is. So these are the person I pick. The rest is I feel that it doesn't bring out Ah Kew character, or I feel that it's not so much, or it's overlapping with the other character, because the seven character I pick, actually their background is very different. All seven of them is very different. Some is really famous, some is nobody, some with a mythos background, so they are all sorts of people. So it has a variety that to tell what Ah Kew is, he's writing on this type of people, from famous to not so famous.
So how many hours of footage you had to work with when you started cutting?
Can't remember, maybe 30, 40 maybe. This one not so bad. So the Wayakudi one is even 50 hours is even worse. 50 hours is almost don't know what to do with the footages. 50 hours. But 50 hours, not all of them is interview. Actually, interview is just a small portion. I mean, not a small portion, but Wayakudi is different. When you shoot a Wayang show, it's probably 1 hour and a half. So it's a very long stretch. So you can see whether you want to include or you don't want to include. So putting them together is for me is work best is actually get the footages, trim them down. So you get fewer and fewer. So from 50 you get to 25, go to 12, go to 8, go to 7, go to 6. So get until the length that you feel that is okay already, then is the part. How to put them together is another story. How to put them together, character A, character B, character C, how to put them into place. This part a bit tricky, because it depends on every film have different method. I would say it's depending, it really depends. Some is can be like this one that actually use actually this one is still okay lah. I think the flow is quite it will bring from one to another, or doesn't have really need to have a flow. The Wayakudi one is really cracking my head, because every dalang they are saying different dalang, and in between the dalang there's some overlapping things among the dalang, but it doesn't strong enough to bring it through the whole story. So that one I actually do a little bit in between. I shoot some story in between. I shoot a Wayakudi story. So I ask the dalang to play a certain part of the story. Those part actually is a written play. So they will play that part, and I just plumb it in between, like a segment. After certain dalang, I will have that segment then. One. So when the thing come in, you actually tie up everything together into a documentary, and it flows from the beginning to the end. And that part, when I go back, is actually the last part of my shoot. It's the last part. My last shoot, I actually do this, because I cannot cut anymore. I don't know how to tie them together. So eventually, I go and shoot this part, and it works out. It's string everything together.
It's actually interesting, because you didn't go for that standard 3-act three-act sort of a model for documentary. You know, it was just the story, and then it ends with the conflict, and then that's it. And it sort of suggests that there's a sequel to the story. Would you say that the Raja Lawood film is sort of a sequel to this film? Or would that be a completely separate film?
I think separate, just another collaboration. But the style is pretty much, I try to see whether you can have the same method of collaboration and all this, which is pretty much the same way.
We have time for one more question.
All right.
Hello, I'm Akida. I'm interested that you actually gave some credit to Museum Negara. How were they helpful to you?
I think some of the old footage, old photo you see actually is from, the credit's actually from them, so those photo and stuff. So all the black and white photo, not all, I think certain, some are from Ah Kew, some are from the people, some are from the archive, library archive. So yeah. Those black and white photos especially. I think the movie one, especially the movie one.
I'm going to end with this. You featured two criminals in this film. One is that also. One is that. I'm using the word criminal very loosely here. One is that also, and sort of mythological. Not sure, you know, like how many days he got drowned, and you know, and the other one was Raja Lawood. You went on to make a film about Raja Lawood. Do you have plans to make or do something about that also? Just curious.
I think the I don't have a specific criteria to pick certain characters, except there has to be some interesting elements on them. So I don't really care if they are a good guy or bad guy or nobody or what. So I think as long as if I do a film of certain one person, then I have to make sure he has to be enough material and interesting enough to be one episode alone. So that is, I think, is a crucial part for me. I think that also is still not enough of that, unless I go and think, or unless I do know a lot about him, then we can probably do another one. Because I do actually know about Raja now quite a lot, quite extensive, because his mother is actually from the fishing village. So when he's small, his mother telling him the story about her neighborhood, like this story. Actually, there's more than one Raja now, there's a lot. So these are the interesting two. One of them is this one, the other one is speaking to another documentary, which also he know quite a bit of it. But before we shoot the documentary for that one, he didn't go to Sumatra to see the other side of the story. So the story he got is pretty much everything from Malaysian side. So we know the pirate, we know that pirate from the Malaysian eye, how does it? But when we go over there, it's actually a different story. And it's the first time for us to realize that. So it's a bit tricky when we shoot it, especially the beginning of the visit there, because there the people is still, the thinking is a bit, they're not so open up yet in terms of information. So when we go there, they actually, we have problem interviewing people. They didn't grant us for interview. They will say, no, I don't want to talk about
So many of them didn't allow us to interview, to shoot them. So like, we don't know what happened and we don't know how to start. So slowly we go and ask around, and we realize actually here is there, over there is something like I just say the reason, the when I go and interview them, they will say that of course they will tell me this is later we go and talk to other people, so they will tell us if I tell about these pirates, of course from their side is actually this pirate is a bad guy because you coming from Malaysia and you come and rob the people in Sumatra, so that's why they kill him and he was killed in Sumatra, never got back to Malaysia. So they will think that you Malaysian come here and one day after the interview ready, you gather all the information about who is the person who against him, then the Malaysian will have sent somebody here and something like give trouble to them and harm them or whatever. It's like you are seeking revenge, which you have we have to explain that in our following interview. So we have to, the following interview when we start, we have to tell them that we are here but we are not doing seeking revenge or anything like that. We just want to shoot a story about him. And so this is going to be a film. Because some of them living in the Raja Lao era at that time, they still believe in the clan system. So the Malaysian clan, we shouldn't mess around with Malaysian clan, they might send somebody else against after us. So they still believe in that kind of thinking. So we tell them it's actually no more. Even in Perak, nobody is going to be like a supporter of this thing and all this. So we have, after we do some explanation to all these people, and we can go into their world and they'll tell us the story about Raja Lao from their perspective. So we have, after that we sort of okay with the interview. So yeah.
Okay, I guess that's all the time we have. We've spoken a lot about the second film, the Pirate and the Emperor ship. Can we watch this film on YouTube?
Nobody uploaded yet. Maybe God, I don't know.
Do you have plans to upload the film yourself?
No.
No way. Yeah. Okay. Well, I guess you can buy a copy from you if you want to.
Yeah.
Okay. Or otherwise, we may try to persuade him to allow us to screen that film here in the future. Thank you very much for coming today.
Thank you.
Thank you.